Good afternoon. I'm Bill DeLuca. This is Theater of Revolt. This is our fifth class on June 12th here. Looking forward to Father's Day next Sunday, but today we're going to enjoy probably one of the most pivotal plays in this whole class, Flying West by Pearl Clegg, a beautifully written play. And if you've never heard of it, hopefully this will gain you some appreciation for just how a playwright works, because Pearl Clegg is a terrific one. So look forward to talking with you about Flying West, a play about black liberation, and a play that certainly fits into our Theater of Revolt concept here, which is what is at the center of this humanities class, basically how playwrights have used theater to voice their opposition. And this is a play about black independence. It's a great historical play about Nicodemus, Kansas, so it's got history, but many contemporary relative points to make about life today and racism today. So hope you'll join us. We try to make this as interactive as we can. So we are live here at Distance Learning. So feel free to either use the phone or our online service. There's the phone number right there. Free anywhere in North America, 1-800-339-1193. And if you call, we can answer your question or just take an observation that you're making about the play. Or you may want to log on with most of our students at dhtv.csudh.edu and post a question or a comment, and they'll bring them up here on the screen, so I'll be able to tell the listening audience, the viewing audience, what you've said. So it'll be something of a discussion, an attempt at it at least. Theater is very much a collaborative art, not just among the designers and the playwrights and the actors, directors who create it, but with that audience as well. It's interesting that in theater, the lights never go dark. In a movie theater, you definitely want everything to be in the dark, otherwise it'll disturb you, but in a live piece of theater, you see all the audience around you, no matter how focused the one instrument is on a character, it lights up the full theater. So you're never alone in the house in a piece of theater. It is meant to be a community engagement. So, sorry for the lecture, but would love to hear from you is the point. And in order to develop some questions that maybe you'd like to respond to, here are some focus questions for today. And some of these are from our students. Actually, the first one is not, but our students have on the discussion board, there's a part of our website here where students are making questions as well as responses to the plays that they're reading every week. And a lot of them have been talking about the stereotyping that goes into some of the plays they've been reading. It's very difficult to write a play without stereotyping. To some extent, you have to represent a certain type of character that people will recognize. So if you're creating the father of the family in the situation of the play, that person has to act in fatherly ways. There's maybe a protective quality, or maybe there's a lecturing quality. Some say I can be very fatherly. Roman scholar Horace, way back in Roman times, wrote about what he called decorum, that a certain actor must behave in what we now call believably as, let's say, the father. So to some extent, you can't just put any kind of character qualities in there. It has to conform to some type. But what happens when you go to a point where it's stereotypical? So that's our first question for today. How can a playwright avoid stereotyping characters when, in reality, part of the art of writing good characters is that you want someone who people can recognize? You wouldn't want the father of the play acting like some young romantic lead. So, tough question, actually, but it's been something of a fascination for our students in the class. Here's another question, and Kathy Cribbins brought this up about character. In fact, if you don't mind, I'm actually going to read a little bit of what Kathy wrote here, because it's quite good. I don't know if you guys can bring this up on the screen, Ileana, but I'll read it instead, perhaps. But Kathy said, Proclay gives us vibrant and differing characters in Flying West to illustrate life after slavery. The play actually does take place in the 1870s, 1890s. She actually sets it 1890s, but it's more like the post-Reconstruction South after slavery. There are themes other than the quest for freedom woven through this narrative. I believe that Miss Leah is defined by the hope she has for the future generations. Her strength comes from enduring slavery and accepting her purpose in a seemingly unjust world. This is supported when Miss Leah states to Minnie that, quote, none of this makes any sense without the children. And then in the closing act, she tells Minnie's newborn daughter, quote, I'm going to tell you about your mama, and her grandmama before that. All those strong colored women making a way for you, little old you, end of quote. And then she asks the question, choose another character and support what you think defines them. Kathy, that's a great question, and I love the way you set it up by showing a little analysis of Miss Leah, giving us examples that represent her hopefulness for the future. And that's one thing that makes this play so unique. It is theater of revolt to a certain extent because it's arguing against the status quo. These women have come from a very violent post-Reconstruction South where white redeemers are beginning to develop what becomes the Ku Klux Klan, and they leave their home to basically go to Kansas and start their own farm. So it is a play about black independence and finding something hopeful for the future. But the play doesn't linger in negative divisiveness. It's very hopeful. Miss Leah is a perfect character to use because she doesn't just complain through the play about the slavery days. She has a kind of inspiring ability to see kind of a Moses-like quality for how these women could follow in her path. But great question. Choose another character and support what you think defines them. So that's our second question. Choose a character from Flying West and tell what you think defines them. Thank you, Kathy, for that. Here's another question. Who is the protagonist in the play and what are they struggling against? And Daniel, I want to thank you because it's not an easy question. Usually your protagonist is someone who is pretty obvious. But in this play, you're not exactly sure. There's a number of characters who could serve as the protagonist, and that's what makes your question rather interesting, Daniel. Let me see if I can find... Yes, here it is. Let me just comment. And I'm reading this because many of these comments in our discussion board are written so well that they have a nice focus. But Daniel basically said, who is the protagonist of the play? Sophie, Miss Leah, or another character? And what are they struggling or revolting against? Is it the racism of the country, or people like Frank, or something else? So that's great, Daniel. You gave us a couple choices there, but you clarified what you were asking for. It's not that easy to ask a clear question. A good question shows that you've thought about it and that you actually understand the play. So don't think that just posing a question, which is what I'm asking each student to do, to pose one question and to respond to another student's question in the discussion board. So don't think that asking the question is the easy part. Sometimes you have to really think about it in order to get a good focus. So there's our three focus questions for today. Feel free to call or log on to ask any question of your own or to make any comments about the play. I don't want to limit you to these three, but these are just there to help you perhaps respond to the play. So there's our phone number, and there's our website, so feel free to join us. Just a little bit of business I do have to do with students, just because we're kind of moving towards a midterm time. So I just want to alert you to what is coming up. But this week, yes, we're reading Flying West, and next week we actually are going to read Antigone. We're going to go back to a classical play to see if Revolt is something that applies to pre-19th century times, because we really began the course looking at Ibsen as the father of modern drama, and that modern drama somehow has something to do with Revolt. But let's see if it goes back with some classical roots. So we're going back to classical Greek tragedy and the story of Antigone for next week. But the following week is exam week, and I just want students to know that the midterm is going to be posted for you to be available to answer from June 20th to midnight of the 24th. It's multiple choice and true and false. You don't have to face any kind of essay. It's all about the plays. So anything I'm saying about the art or the history or the philosophy of these eras as I set them up in our discussion, you can disregard. It is about the characters, the action, the themes in the play. In fact, we have a study guide that I just sent to the students, so hopefully you have that. And that is your golden clue. That's what I use to make up the tests, all right? But it's all about the plays themselves. I guess one of the main objectives in this class is to not only see the concept aspect of the class, because it is kind of a thesis-based course. We are looking at how the play reflects a kind of revolutionary statement, whether you're speaking against the status quo, whether you're trying to pose a new order, whether it is a revolt that is political, or it may be even stylistic. It may be attempting to look for new forms in ways of creating an art piece. So we're looking at revolt, but to some extent, it's important to realize that we're also looking at how plays are put together, and that's a unique part of even the thesis-based aspect of this. And just as Kathy just did in posing that question to us, using evidence from the play to support a point you're making is very, very important. And that's why the midterm is really just focusing on the plays. I want you to know the characters. You should know what side of the city Jerry lives in and what side of the city Peter lives in from Zeus' story. It's actually a point of the division between them that makes them so different as characters. So these, I guess I'm saying, please give the plays a lot of focus and detailed study. And that's the best way to prepare for the midterm. And that's all the plays from the beginning that we've read, including Trifles, which is going to be, we're reading Antigone next week. Trifles is a 10-page play that actually you read in that exam week. So that's what's covered in the play, the exam. And really, I'm asking you to kind of get inside the play. It's one thing to stand apart from a play and tear it apart. It's different to get inside the play and take it apart, see how it works. That's what hopefully we'll do today with Flying West. But I see we have someone on the phone here, so this is terrific. Who's calling? Catherine, calling from Culver City. Thank you, Catherine. Thanks for calling.
Yes, hi. Good morning. I'm actually calling about the third question that you have on the focus question.
Excellent.
On the protagonist and what they're struggling against.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess my first question was, when I read Daniel's question on the question board, is can you have more than one protagonist in a play?
There's a couple of questions implied in there, but yeah, focus on whatever one you want, Catherine. That's fine.
Okay, so I was thinking that the antagonist of the play is Frank, because he's trying to he's trying to go against Minnie in the sense of letting her do, he attacks her basically. He's also going against Sophie in the sense that he's trying to sell the property. Mm-hmm. And he's going against everybody in the play in the sense that he's not acting as a black man, so to speak. He's trying to be more white than black. And so I think he personally is the main character that's stopping all the other characters from doing what they want.
That's great, Catherine. In fact, it's interesting that Frank represents another major antagonist in this, which is white society. And it's odd that Frank, being mulatto, is representing more of the white races at the time. So, yeah, that's a good...
Yeah.
I think you're right. He's truly the antagonist. But now, who do you feel is the protagonist?
Well, that's why I had a hard time with that one in this play, is trying to define who was trying to get something done and how Frank was stopping him. So, mm-hmm. To me, I wasn't really sure if you can only have one or if you could have multiple protagonists, because it seemed there was multiple messages in the play itself.
I don't want to sound like I'm avoiding the question, but there's something that Pearl Clegg wants to write about women as a group becoming a community to help them through difficulty. So I think you actually have an interesting point there, that maybe it's the group of women who are the protagonist. I like that idea.
I mean, that's where I was going, but as a play, I wasn't sure if there really only is one person trying to get something done, because I saw Frank going against or trying to stop. But I guess if you were to look at just one person, I would probably say that it would have to be Minnie in one sense, because she's the one that is ultimately stopped, and that's why they end up killing Frank at the end of the play.
And that great moment at the end where she actually has to go to his body, and she puts her hand in and she pulls out the deed.
Yeah.
That's a major confrontation. Even though Frank is dead, it's a tough one for Minnie to do. So that's a good point.
She loves him so much. I mean, Minnie loved Frank so much that even in his death, it was hard for her. But I felt like she had a change of, like she just had an epiphany at that moment when she saw that he was dead and realized that her love didn't really mean anything, and she was so much better for it at that point.
That's great, Catherine. I mean, I quoted, I think, in here earlier that we go to a play to be moved, and the pain that you sense that Minnie is going through at that time, because she did love him and had to agree to his being put away, it's difficult.
Yeah.
It's a difficult,
you're
suffering along with her.
Yeah.
So that's a great observation. Well, listen, when we get to read the play, I'm going to do that, hopefully in about a half an hour. Let's track that and see if we can say Minnie is the protagonist.
Okay.
But that's great, Catherine. Good observations, and I think everybody will agree with you, surely, about Frank being the antagonist.
Yeah.
Thank you, Catherine. Please call again. That was great. Good observations. Great observations. So as you see, we have a play that kind of draws a lot of interest. What I do want to do, though, is talk a little bit about Pearl Clegg, just to kind of set it up, because she's a very interesting writer and a very good writer as well. Clegg is, she is an activist. She is not just a playwright. She's not just a poet. She's not just a novelist. And certainly she's not just a playwright. She is an inspired woman, and very much like a lot of the women in this play, a representation that people can only look up to. She's truly a child of the 1960s. Her father was a minister in Detroit. She actually heard Martin Luther King as well as Malcolm X speak, and her parents were very involved in the movement. She went to college at Howard and at Yale, later Atlanta, all during the 1960s. So she was part of a lot of the statements of revolt in her life. She married a politician. Later they were divorced, though, and she remarried a theater producer in Atlanta, Zarin Burnett, who runs the Alliance Theater in Atlanta, and a lot of her plays were opened there in Atlanta. But one of the things that Pearl Clegg has written, and I'm sorry that I didn't bring it to read to you today, although it's quite disturbing, it's a series of essays that she wrote back in 1993 called Deals with the Devil and Other Reasons to Riot. Interesting title, considering our concept for the course. And one of the opening essays features her talking about some of the violence. This is 1993, so it's a little out of date, but unfortunately, I don't know. I hope that it's improved a lot. But she refers to a lot of incidents where black men were abusing young children as well as older women. And it was quite graphic the way she describes some of the horrible events that were there. But then she poses the question, is it okay to say that black men can do this because of racism, because of all these years of slavery? Can we stand up and say, well, it makes sense. Obviously, slavery caused the black man to have to do this to express his revolt. And she firmly comes out and says, absolutely not. We cannot justify the abuse of black women by black men because of those boats that showed up and brought 10 to 15 million Africans into slavery in the Caribbean and the South. I mean, she documents the horrors of slavery, but she also says, does that really serve as a reason that we can accept this injustice against our own people? So a lot of the infighting is reflected, and we'll see in Flying West, too, that that is very much something that she wanted to take up. She wrote in Deals with the Devil about how she wanted to expose and explore the point where racism and sexism meet. And it's a, if you ever get a chance to read some of the articles, and they're actually beautifully written. She's quite a writer. She knows how to draw emphasis. In fact, when you read in her novels or essays how she makes a point so cleanly, you understand why she's a good playwright. She knows how to draw our attention. You may not agree with some of the points that she's making, but you have to applaud, in a way, how she does it. Very, very artistic in the way that she writes. So, yeah, themes of determination, racism, miscegenation, feminism, obviously, pride, and certainly freedom. These are all in Pearl Clegg's many works. We did Blues for an Alabama Sky here. We also did a production of Flying West. She's great for actors, great for directors as well. But let's just talk a little bit about the background of this play, because it's a historical play. It's very interesting to track why she focused on this unique experiment, Nicodemus, Kansas, end of the 19th century. Obviously, the rebellion against slavery started very early. So in terms of Theater of Revolt, going back to articles by Samuel Sewall, Montesquieu, Voltaire. Voltaire said that slavery is the most unnatural thing for man to do in his life. Phyllis Wheatley, a lot of her poetry, 1760s, introduced many revolutionary ideals as well. And David Walker, who wrote in the early 19th century, was actually very militant and frightened many whites because of some of the revolution that he was advocating. But the evidence is there. Colonialism, European colonialism, really needed slave labor to bring sugar, cotton, coffee back to Europe. So in the years up to the beginning of the 19th century, up to 15 million Africans were brought to the Caribbean to work these plantations. And what's amazing, this sounds like a ridiculous statistic, but it's actually true. The average length of a man's life, a black man's life, who was brought to the Caribbean to work in the sugarcane plantations, the average length of their life, 7 years. You know the phrase, you know, you work people to death. You know, it's almost like a laughing kind of humor that you say, you know, I'm working to death. You say that a number of times. This was the invention of that phrase. I mean, 7 years and you're dead. I mean, that's how horrendous the plantation life was, not only in the Caribbean but in the South. So there was a violent reaction against it. Revolt was there, but it wasn't until François-Dominique Toussaint de Louverture, who actually created a revolt in Haiti, that succeeded. 1794, we actually had a successful slave revolution, and that became inspiring for many. Langston Hughes actually wrote a play about Louverture. And so it gave a kind of hero to work on. In America, abolition began very early. Actually, the Quakers started very early in 1720s as a moral crusade. And they published many slave narratives because people in the North did not know about conditions in the South. Add to that the work of Harriet Tubman, Sojourner Truth, Frederick Douglass, who not only was speaking quite a lot but publishing his work, all the way up to Harriet Beecher Stowe, who wrote Uncle Tom's Cabin, and Abraham Lincoln said to her, "Sir, you're the little lady who started this war," referring to the Civil War. Very interesting that Harriet Beecher Stowe never permitted her book to be made into a play. And she was justified because when it was made into a play, it became a melodrama that lost all of its social purpose. But that's another topic. But it's very interesting that she was writing similarly to what the Quakers were doing, writing as a moral crusade, and didn't want to see it made into a show and in some way minimized in terms of its importance. And the Civil War was an attempt, obviously, to erase the evil, and there was some progress with Reconstruction. By the 1870s, free men were actually taking office. Black men were taking office, but then federal government withdrew troops in 1877, and then we begin a very ugly period in American history where white groups who called themselves redeemers, interesting kind of Christian phrase to use, conducted their own revolt and developed what was first known as the Black Codes, which were restrictions against the civil rights of blacks, and later developed into what we call the Jim Crow laws, which established legal segregation. That's legal segregation right there. You go to this restroom, we go to this one. Public buses, education. So segregation became established by the separate but equal idea that later became known as Jim Crow. I'll tell you where that phrase came from. You'll be kind of disappointed in me when you hear. But the idea of using poll taxes or literacy tests, comprehension tests, residency record keeping requirements before you can vote or perform any civic duties, this is how these black codes worked. And it came down to the 1896 Homer Plessy decision, which actually established for the next 58 years, legal discrimination. And it wasn't until 1954 with Brown versus Board of Education and then finally the Civil Rights Act of 1965 that America finally put away its own version of apartheid, which was a legal, understand, legal segregation. It wasn't just the certain areas of the country were biased. It was legal to separate. So it's interesting that prior to the Civil War, the North wanted to create the Homestead Act to get settlers to go out into these new areas like Kansas and start to build the American West, right? And as early as the 1850s, but the South was very suspect that they would lose competition, they would lose competition for their projects, products, and they would lose slaves. So the South and the North fought against this for years. Finally, with the Civil War, 1862, Lincoln pushes through the Homestead Act, which basically says if you're over 21 and you live on the land for 5 years, it's yours. I mean, what a great deal in terms of trying to bring settlers out west. Spain had done this themselves in California, trying to bring families from Mexico to come up to California and settle the land to prevent, in that case, the Russians from coming down from Alaska. So a very interesting piece of history there. And in fact, Dominguez, the origins of Dominguez Hills, is actually the first Spanish land grant in the West here, where 75,000 acres went to a family known as the Dominguez family. And that's where our university actually originates from. So this idea of settling the West becomes a major act of colonization, yes, and but it was a good deal. So this is what Pearl Clegg seized upon when she wanted to focus on the famous 1870s expedition of a number of ministers, W.R. White, H.R. Smith, and a number of other black ministers who created the Nicodemus Town Company and built an all-black community, which was very hard to start. The Osage Indians evidently helped them enormously in getting established. But by 1885, there were 700 people living there. It was a full town with a post office. They actually had schools, even though Pearl Clegg's play seems to imply that there wasn't a school yet. There was a restaurant there. They had stables. So they were well on their way, except that the railroad bypassed Nicodemus, which hurt. However, it continued all the way through the Depression, even though many people left, and it's still going today. In fact, it has an annual Emancipation Celebration Day, so it's made it on its own. Very interesting piece of Black history, the Nicodemus town experiment. And in terms of the thinking behind this, it's also very interesting that Rousseau is saying that man is born free and is everywhere in chains. This applied very strongly to the American South, but Rousseau was basically asking that we go back to nature, that we live a little more free of the social restraints that are being put upon us by European society. But it did help establish the concept of the romantic hero, which becomes very important, especially in theater in the 1830s, 1840s. But Mr. Darwin is probably the most revolutionary thinker in all these early years, who basically established this idea that survival depends on who was the fittest, rather than who has divine intervention or even who has more money. So that concept of determination is very much at the heart of Flying West. But one of the other thinkers of the 19th century was Herbert Spencer, who took Darwinism and made his own application of what has come to be known as social Darwinism, which is that survival of the fittest, if you apply it to human institutions, it means that if you are rich and powerful, like many European nations were at the end of the 19th century, then you are most fit to march into Africa or India or China and establish that you have the more superior culture. So to some extent, Darwinism was used in a rather negative way to establish racism. And by the end of the 19th century, yes, we were moving towards the colonialism of Africa, and World War I was right around the corner. So it's an interesting time that Clegg picks upon to focus on this Nicodemus, Kansas experiment and use it for Flying West. And also, just to cover a little bit of art, realize that when slaves were brought to the American South, they were not permitted to dance the many, many dances or make the elaborate, wonderful masks that they used in their ceremonies, their ritual ceremonies, which artists like Picasso would later be inspired by and draw a lot of inspiration from African masks. So the art development was rather disrupted for Black Americans. And one of the strangest theatrical moments in history is the Black Minstrel Show. And we talked a little bit about stereotyping in Electricidad. This is clearly the worst case that America has to offer in terms of stereotyping, because what we get is an international sensation where white actors caricature Black dancers and singers that they saw on plantations in what becomes, for a good century, a very harsh portrayal of Black Americans as being stupid, illiterate, eating watermelon and chicken. This whole horrendous stereotype was developed through theater. Unfortunately, I have to say, it began with a performer, and his name was Thomas Rice. And Rice created a character that he called Jim Crow. And Rice had witnessed some of the plantation entertainments. Some of the masters of the plantations would allow their slaves to dance and sing, and many of them didn't. In fact, it kind of divided the South. Many whites who did not own slaves really resented that some of the masters were allowing their Negroes to sing their spirituals on the plantation. But what Rice and many other white actors did was blacken their face with cork and enlarge their lips and sing a rather kind of overly exaggerated version of what they saw on the plantations. So Rice actually toured along the Ohio River with this character that he made famous, and many other performers began to pick it up until it became an actual show, the minstrel show. And we have the Virginia Minstrels, we have a number of different minstrel groups who traveled all around, not just the South, okay? This became a hit in England, in France. It was an international sensation. Basically what it was a semicircle of 13 white actors in blackface playing tambourines, playing bones, and basically singing songs, doing comic skits. It was like vaudeville. It was a variety entertainment, if you will. But it became a sensation because of the gross caricature. Spike Lee actually did a wonderful film called Bamboozled where he features a segment of a minstrel show in that. But even though this was 1850s, 1860s, when after the Civil War, black actors were allowed to join the minstrel show, then they actually would blacken their face even more and enlarge their lips and continue to promote this gross stereotype all the way through to the Harlem Renaissance. It really was Langston Hughes and Marcus Garvey and Zora Neale Hurston who said, hold on here. We have to portray ourselves in a more authentic manner in not only theater, but film and television were right around the corner. So it became a kind of political effort to correct this aberration that happened for 80, 90 years. And it really was the work of great performers like Burt Williams. Burt Williams was the first black man on Broadway. And even though he did perform in blackface, he helped move theater more towards a more elegant show of a man dancing in top hat, cane, with a whole bevy of beautiful girls behind him. The Ziegfeld Follies, basically. Burt Williams was very instrumental in helping to develop that. And the black musicals of the 1920s became very pivotal in moving in a new direction. So I bring it up because it is a kind of sad fact that Jim Crow, as we refer to it, in fact, it's referred to in the play, the idea that blacks had to face segregation, that actual word comes from a theatrical character that was created in the 1820s and became famous in the black minstrel shows. So not something to stand up and cheer about. When theater can be used quite negatively on stage to mock others. And interesting that we'll see this for Asian Americans, we'll see it for Hispanic Americans, we'll see it for women, and every group has to, in a way, go to the street and argue against this stereotyping in almost every ethnic or cultural group. Theater was used to somehow correct this stereotyping. So it's a very odd history that theater somehow can dedicate, but it's worth following to see how many of these stereotypes have been correcting, and we still live with it today, so it's not like it was totally eradicated. But theater has helped to keep our mindset on that point and make sure that we have authentic portrayals of all peoples on stage. Meanwhile, some of the black artists who were painting were able to develop their works. Horace Pippin was probably the first black artist who was given a major exposition at MoMA, the Museum of Modern Art, in 1938. Pippin had no formal training, and he was kind of regarded, there's one of his works there. This is an interior, but he was early 20th century. He was called a folk artist because he didn't have much training. But what he does here is not too different than what Monet had been doing when the Impressionists began moving away from absolute realism and trying to give a sense of depth. This frontality, this kind of two-dimensionality, is meant to be more of an abstract version so that it stands for more things. It's more myth-based rather than realism-based. So Horace Pippin, very instrumental artist in letting African Americans find a more freedom, a freer voice in a way in terms of their painting. And Jacob Lawrence, once we get to the middle of the 20th century, is also very fascinated with portraying abstractions in his work. And it really puts him into a modern school. When you look, for instance, at this famous painting he did of Tubman leading the Underground Railroad. I think this is called the Underground Railroad. Oh, no, sorry, it's called Forward. And it's a wonderful, masterful economy. It eliminates all the details, but what is essential there? And obviously this powerful image of Harriet Tubman literally enforcing the Underground Railroad to some extent creates her kind of heroic sense of pride. So, but you notice the flatness in that composition. It was not meant to be realistic. So to some extent, there's almost a political need to move away from realism, and we'll see that in many, many artists. It's been something of a theme that we followed through a lot of this. All right, well, let's talk a little bit about this play, which is quite a wonderful piece of work. Flying West has had many, many productions. It's still done quite a lot. Perhaps because of its historical connection, it's done quite a lot in colleges and theaters across the nation. Our own picture here is from Montclair State, a production that was done in New Jersey, and it's a great image of the women doing the ritual. But it's been done in arena. There's a production that was done at Buffalo, for instance, where you see Frank's paternity being denied in a great moment from Act Two. And there you can see the image there. I don't know how close you can get in, but you can see that another reason why this play is done so often is it gives you a chance to look at period costumes as well. You do have to have enough of a budget to do a show like this. But this is the reading of that telegram from the brothers. And obviously it's staged very well to bring emphasis to that point. Look how you're really focused on Fanny reading that. We have another image from Washington, D.C. of a professional production. And this is actually Frank just at that moment before reading the, and you can see how light-skinned Frank is compared to Will back there. But again, costumes, very critical part of being able to do a show like this. And then finally, the Montclair State production was done quite wonderfully and really capturing such a great moment of revolt there. And again, this is the play itself, truly an essential moment. The play is not a complaint against white society. The play is a very positive statement of the future. This is not Miss Leah who's in there. It's the girls. So you have Sophie and Fanny and Minnie. But what a great uplifting moment, obviously. And there's Frank, you can see in the background, looking on rather suspiciously at what these women think they're doing out there. So, that's the moment that we chose here to focus on for Theater of Revolt. But what I'd like to do is to just read a little bit of the play and then tell you about our applied studies program here. We're going to focus on characters today, and that was one of our focus questions here. But one of the unique things that a playwright does is create character. And when we read a play, we sit and we try to follow it, right? We try to understand what's going on. But when you stop and watch and see how they did that, how they put it together. So I guess that's what I'm asking you to do with me, is to take a little bit of a look inside the play here to see how it works, to capture the real artistry of what Clegg has done. Obviously, you should read the play from beginning to end, straight through, just to get the storyline clear, to find out what happens of the play, right? But to be able to take a moment and go inside the play to see how the playwright accomplishes it, that's part of the main goal for our class here. But Yes, we're certainly going to look at how it fits into Theater of Revolt, but we also want to keep a little bit of a focus on just how Clegg does this. So let's talk a little bit about Sophie and Leah first, because they are the ones who begin the play. The play begins with an actually quiet scene. Nobody's saying anything in this opening. And I guess I have to ask you, what is revealed by this opening sequence here? Obviously, Pearl Clegg felt that she wanted you to see something before anybody said the first line. So there's a little bit of setting that she talks about. Sophie enters rapidly. Her heavy coat is unbuttoned, and her scarf flies out about her neck. It is chilly, but the cold has exhilarated her. She has just returned from a trip into town. She has a large bag of flour slung over her shoulder and a canvas shoulder bag full of groceries. She's carrying a shotgun, which she places by the door. She slings the bag of flour carelessly on the table and, coat still on, puts the other bag on the chair. She fumbles through her pockets, first withdrawing a letter, which she holds for a moment thoughtfully. Then she sticks it in the growing pile on the overflowing desk. She fumbles through her pockets again and withdraws some very long strips of black licorice. She takes a bite, sighs, chews appreciatively. She pulls a chair over to the window, opens it wide, sits down, propping her booted feet up on the windowsill. She looks out the window with great contentment, takes another bite of licorice, chews slowly, completely satisfied with the candy sweetness, the chill in the air, and the privacy of the moment. Now, that's a lot of information that Pearl Clegg wants you to see first. Do you think she's saying that Sophie is a lazy person who looks for any opportunity to put her feet up and just rest? Is she always doing this, eating on licorice, not caring about anything? If it makes you even wonder that question, that's great, because you're going to find out that Sophie is the tractor of the play. I mean, she is dedicated to this goal of ensuring that this town survives as an all-black town. We're going to find that later in the dialogue. But it's interesting the actions that Pearl Clegg gives this character to do. First of all, walking in with a bag of flour on your, and slinging it down. This is not your typical trip back from Vons, right? She actually does have a bag of groceries as well. But she's also carrying a shotgun. You don't need that when you go to Vons, right? So this image of just her entrance tells you where these women are and when they're living here. For you to have to walk around with a shotgun, this places the play accurately. So we know the who, where, when of what's going on. Situation is being told in a way that we visually can see it. And then you ask that question, well, why does she put her feet up on the windowsill and sit there and appreciatively eat her licorice? I don't know, maybe somebody who is watching might want to go against my idea that she's lazy and she's tired or she's just, she does this all the time, looks for a chance to get out of doing any work. I don't know, maybe one of my students who's listening can react against my point there. So, yeah, what does that opening action tell? A good playwright always begins the play with something that is very important. Even if you in the audience don't understand exactly what it is, if it's something that visually connects you and makes you wonder what it is, then that's even perhaps better. A little bit of an ambiguous point there that focuses you. So what does that action tell us? That's a very unique part. So in come Miss Leah now enters. And I'm just going to read you a little bit of the opening dialogue, and then we'll take a break here and give you something to respond to. But now Miss Leah is the matriarch of the play. This is the older woman. In fact, she enters haltingly. She walks unsteadily but has no cane. I think it says that she's in her 70s, but she was almost, at least in today's standards, more of her 80s or 90s. We're all living longer lives and rather healthily at that. But she's Haltingly is a great adverb that Clegg uses here. She walks unsteadily, but has no cane to steady herself, so she holds onto the furniture as she walks slowly into the room. She's looking for something, and her manner is exasperated. Sophie does not notice her entering. Miss Leah looks at Sophie, immediately notices the open window, and her irritation increases. And Miss Leah says, "Well, ain't you something?" Sophie says, "Oh, I didn't know you were up, Miss Leah. What a piece," offers her the licorice. And Miss Leah says, "I hate licorice." Miss Leah stumbles a little. Sophie moves to steady her, right, to go to help Miss Leah because she stumbled. And Miss Leah gives her a "don't you dare" look. Great stage direction. And Sophie says, "You miss your cane?" Miss Leah says, "I don't need no cane. I told you that before. You can lay it next to my bed or prop it against the chair like it walked out there on its own. It still ain't going to make me no never mind. I don't want no cane, and I don't need no cane." Sophie says, "Suit yourself." What does that little dialogue say? And why did Clegg want that to be the first thing that happens in this relationship? Is she establishing that these two women are against each other and are going to somehow murder each other? I mean, how much is there a hatred here in this antagonism? So it's a little unique way to start the play. And, you know, one of the things about understanding plays, I'll just leave you with this, is if Miss Leah lived with Sophie this many years, because these people know each other very well, then Sophie would know that Miss Leah doesn't like licorice by now, right? They're living on this open plain in Kansas. You can look around everywhere, and there's no other houses. You're living on this farm. You got to know that this woman doesn't like licorice. Why would you offer licorice, right? Is that a mistake that the playwright wrote? Well, there's a difference between real life and a play. The playwright has to let you know this information. It has to be conveyed in a way that brings out, let's say, this almost gentle antagonism that goes on between Sophie and Miss Leah, perhaps because they're so much alike, they tangle constantly. But the playwright has to give us expositionary information in the beginning. And it's not just that she dislikes licorice. In fact, we're going to see Miss Leah, this matriarchal woman, sit down and smoke a pipe of tobacco. She is on the rough side rather than licorice, which is on the sweet side. So it's almost establishing character in a very important way. It's telling the audience who you are. If you stand back from the play and say, "Oh, but that doesn't make sense. She would know that she doesn't like licorice." Well, yeah, you can ask those realistic questions, but that's from our own life, right? In a play, it's a little different. It's an artistic creation. It is not just real life. So that happens a lot. And the things that a playwright chooses to show you are a way that we are painting our canvas here. We are giving you information. And Clegg does it so, so beautifully. So then Sophie takes another bite of licorice, hangs up her coat. Miss Leah's shawl's hanging there in plain view. Sophie starts to reach for it, stops, ignores it, and begins putting things away. I mean, she knows that Miss Leah does not want her to help her, right? So we've established Miss Leah's sense of independence, and she does represent black independence in a very significant way in this play. And Miss Leah actually says, "I am looking for my shawl, if you must know." And Sophie says, "It's right." And Miss Leah says, "Don't tell me. If you start telling me, you'll just keep at it till I won't be able to remember a darn thing of my own." And Sophie then says, "I'll make you some coffee." Miss Leah says, "I don't know why. Can't nobody drink that stuff but you." And Sophie says, "It'll warm you up." Miss Leah says, "It'll kill me." Sophie says, "Well, then you haven't got much time to put your affairs in order." Miss Leah says, "My affairs are in order, thank you." And she pulls her chair as far from the window as possible, sits with effort, and complains, "It's too cold for 1st of October. And then she says, "Where's my shawl?" And then immediately says, "Don't tell me." Clegg has started the play in almost a humorous way here. We see this antagonism is really not a harsh antagonism. It's almost a game that these two play. And she wanted to start to show you that life ain't easy for these gals living out there. And to some extent, having arguments makes them feel alive. They don't walk through the whole day just quietly. They're allowed to kind of get things out. Is Miss Leah just an old complaining woman? There's a sense of humor here that she is rather playful, despite all the huge amount of horror that she's gone through in life, and we'll find out about that. But the playwright wants you to like the characters, and you watch this fight that's going on between them, and it reminds you of people from your own family who find that somehow making them argue with each other makes them feel most alive, right? We all know people like this. So it's, yes, selected from reality, but it's interesting how Clegg has sculpted it in order to get us to laugh. And the comments about the coffee. Now Sophie says, oh, I bought you some tobacco. Miss Leah says, what kind? Sophie says, the kind you like. Miss Leah is pleased. Says, well, thank you, Sister Sophie. Make a good pipe, can cut the taste of that mess you're cooking up in Fan's coffee pot. So, I mean, she's still ragging on her about the coffee and how bad she is at making coffee. Well, I'll leave you with this. So Miss Leah asks, well, what's irritating you so much? And Sophie says, well, we're going to celebrate my ability not to let these Nicodemus Negroes worry me, no matter how hard they try. And Miss Leah says, well, why? What's the problem? And Miss Leah says, ain't you got enough land to worry about? When Sophie talks about how, you know, I want to preserve the land here. Sophie says an interesting thing. She says, I have enough land when I can step outside my door and spin around with my eyes closed, and wherever I stop, as far as I can see, there is nothing but land that belongs to me and my sisters. Now, it's interesting. Why would she say something like that? In fact, it's a wonderful run-on sentence, but it's actually quite literate the way she speaks it, because it has a kind of musicality to it. You almost feel like she is spinning around in a circle as she's saying it. And that image of Sophie going out back, spinning in a circle and looking around and seeing their own land, it may sound possessive to us today as we live in our huddled communities, but when you're thinking of 1870s, 1880s in the middle of Kansas, which was just established as a state, you are getting what will be the end of the play. It's an interesting thing that Clegg does. She sets up the image of what Sophie's ideal state of happiness is. And at the end of the play, when the girls are going off to the dance, you'll see that Sophie actually does that. It ends here. I'll read you just a little section here. Sophie exits to the yard. As Miss Leah talks to the baby, Sophie walks into the middle of the yard, looks up at the full moon. She extends her arms and slowly turns around to encompass her land, her freedom, the moon, her life, and the life of her sisters. She is completely at peace. So Clegg, in the beginning of the play, sets up the end of the play. And I don't know, Catherine, I'd say the focus on Sophie is so strong in the beginning of the play, I wonder if that doesn't make her the central character. I don't know. We'll see if we get some other responses to some of our focus questions today. But let's take a break here. And when I come back, I'm going to try to do this. It's tough to just read sections of a play and, talk about them, but I would love to get some feedback on some of these sections from some of our students. So hopefully we'll be able to discuss a little bit further Flying West when we come back from our break.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
We have award-winning artist Mary Higuchi, who will unveil her original painting created in celebration of our 50th anniversary of CSU Dominguez Hills. Mary, please join us. The theme of the 50th anniversary is honoring our history, forging our future. And as the university looks to its next 50 years, I hope my painting, E Pluribus Unum, will continue to describe the rich multicultural diversity that is at the heart and core of California State University, Dominguez Hills. Thank you.
My name is Travis Shannon, and I decided to come to Cal State Dominguez Hills to the Digital Media Arts program because of the small class sizes, personal one-on-one attention I receive from instructors, as well as the freedom that I have to create the projects that I want to.
Four.
From Cal State Dominguez Hills Athletics, and this is the Toros Coaches Corner. Today we have with us the women's cross country coach, Deanne Schlobom. Hi, coach.
Hi.
We have one of the more competitive teams we've had last season. Tell us what the team learned from that experience and what we can look forward to this year.
Well, the team learned a lot. They learned to stay focused, they learned to attend practice and be rigorous about their training, and they learned to develop a vision for what they want to accomplish and not to deviate from the course of their vision.
We return almost all of our runners to this year's squad. Is this the year we challenge the elite teams in the conference?
We are in a developmental stage, and the runners we have that we're adding to our program are phenomenal. We have Aston Price out of Riverside College, and we have Bridget Fernandez coming, and I think they'll be a great addition, plus some extras, and I think the team is growing and developing, and you're going to see something exciting from the cross-country team this year.
And which newcomers can we expect to make an immediate impact?
I think you'll see some exciting results from Bridget Fernandez, like I said, and Aston Price, and our returners, Erica Beal. And who knows who else is going to surprise us this year. We'll see what kind of good summer training they've done.
And what do you, as a head coach, look forward to the most from this year's team?
I look forward to each one of the athletes performing to their best and improving their times and building on the program we started last year.
Well, Coach, I thank you for joining us in this edition of the Toros Coaches Corner. And until we see you in the stands, remember to make every day your masterpiece. Go Toros.
Go Toros.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in the humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
I basically took the distance learning course because I'm trying to get my California credential. I'm an out-of-state teacher. It's very convenient. I took last semester the health course from Joanna Chase, and I found that to be to my liking. I could study, relax, do it casually in the confines of my home.
I took one of the distance learning classes basically for convenience. It was nice to be at home in the mornings and watch it at home. Or, you know, if it didn't work out that way, I could tape it and kind of watch it at my own leisure.
Well, I took that distance learning course because it's I'm able to
watch the videos anytime I want at my convenience, and it's easy to do that. I can watch it at home or either at the media center, and I would recommend this to a friend.
Teatro Dominguez is a multicultural theater company here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. And the program is designed to do play readings, workshops, and folktale tours to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is that we are not doing theater so much as entertainment, doing theater to help make our lives better. It is community service first and theater second. So, for instance, Teatro would do a play reading of a play about assimilating into American culture if you're an Asian immigrant. And that may be performed in a middle school or here on campus. Had a number of teachers ask Teatro Dominguez to come into their classrooms to read scenes. We have workshops where we would bring a group like Culture Clash in or Cornerstone Theater Company to help our students learn about community-based theater creation. And the touring show is always interesting. Every year we take a folktale or we create a folktale of our own, which is animals talking in masks, and we tour it to local second grade classrooms. So what Teatro does is really educational theater. It is theater that focuses on social issues, and it has more of a direct purpose for society.
Nice paper. Now this is too black. Sweet!
On this job, safety is our first concern. There's a lot that can go wrong. But fortunately, we have Cal State Dominguez Hills, the only authorized OSHA training center in the Los Angeles area. If you're in need of OSHA certification, or if safety is one of your concerns, call 888-4LA-OSHA and learn how to be safe. Remember, safety comes first.
Watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, Bill DeLuca back here at Theater of Revolt. We're doing something rather difficult today. I'm reading sections of a play, Flying West by Pearl Clegg, and hoping that it will transfer out there to the viewing audience or those of you like my students who are looking at it online. But it's a tough way to analyze a play, but let's see. I know I have Catherine here who's responded to one of the questions I already asked. We looked at the opening of the play before the break, and I asked, why does Sophie, this character who comes in with a bag of flour and a shotgun, take a moment to put her foot up and eat a piece of licorice looking out the window there. What does that establish? And I see Catherine saying, I thought that the description says she can take care of herself and doesn't need anyone to help her. And any actor who plays Sophie will agree with you, Catherine, that they're so happy that the playwright gave you that to start the play with. It really shows who you are. A lot of the first 10 pages of a play has to be not just exposition, but you have to establish character. If the audience is going past page 10 and they don't exactly know who you are, you've lost them. You have to show with the first entrance that an actor makes on stage who you are. Any actor will tell you that. But here's a playwright who's really helping you out. So absolutely, Catherine, you're right about that. And I love your next point, too. The candy and the boot up is a reward for safely completing her mission of the day. And that has nice reverberation, too, Catherine, because what they're doing here is not easy. So to some extent, even if it's just a moment of having a piece of licorice to look out over your land through the window with your foot up, it's you earned it. This is hard work. So it's not someone who's just lazy. You're establishing that Sophie wants it really badly. She's not just a worker bee who just can't stop working. She has a vision, and she wants to be able to see a happier future. So a very important image to start to play with. So thank you, Catherine. Let me ask some more questions. Maybe I can get some other students to join us here. But I'm following the play for students who have the copy that I have. I can say page numbers, perhaps, if you'd like, but I'm on page 9 here. Interesting little debate that Miss Leah has with Sophie. Miss Leah says, I was not prepared to put up with a whole lot of mouth. She's talking about coming from the South to Kansas. Colored men always trying to tell you how to do something, even if you've been doing it longer than they've been peeing standing up. Now, this is the kind of thing that Miss Leah says. She's got quite a comic sensibility in her storytelling. And then she says, about peeing standing up, she says to Sophie, they got that in common with you. And Sophie says, I don't pee standing up. And Miss Leah says, you would if you could. Now, that's a funny joke, and we laugh at it. But is there anything extra significant there? And I offer this, too, because as we're reading a play, one of the hardest things to do is to stop and ask yourself, what does that establish? Yes, it's humorous. You got a great joke going here. But there is something a little manly about Sophie. She obviously is the one walking around with a gun. We're establishing a kind of side of a woman that is more the protector side. And sure enough, when we introduce Fanny, we're going to get the more feminine side. Fanny is associated with flowers. Sophie is associated with gun. These are clear images that help identify for the audience the distinctions between characters. How do you write a play with all these women in it and make sure that the audience doesn't get lost confusing who's which one? So you gotta, in a way, be a little heavy-handed by clarifying who is who. And that's another thing behind the humor of this. I just have to finish this with you, too, because Miss Leah then takes a sip of the coffee that Sophie has made and grimaces. And Sophie says, put some milk in it, Miss Leah. And Miss Leah says, when I want milk, I drink milk. When I want coffee, I want fans coffee. Again, it's another humorous line because you're expecting her to say, I want coffee. When I want coffee, I want coffee. But she says, I want fans coffee. Another put down of Sophie. So Sophie just never hears the end of it about her coffee being so bad. I also want to point something out here, too. This is everyday conversation among people who don't have a lot of education and are basically farmers, right? But there's a flow to it that any actor will tell you, it's fun to speak this. It actually is speakable. And that is one thing that a playwright must consider, that the play is not written for you to stand out there and read. It's meant for actors to memorize and say in a in a scene. When Shakespeare's audiences came to the theater, they would say, let's go hear a play. They would never say, let's go see a play, or like we say, let's go see a movie. They said, let's go hear a play. They knew that the people who were writing the play were poets, right? The Greek writers, people in medieval times, African writers, Indian writers, they were poets who wrote plays. So to some extent, we're seeing poetry here. And I just want to point out the parallelism in this one line. Listen to this. When I want milk, I drink milk. When I want coffee, I want fans coffee. The parallelism of that structure allows it to have a punchline when she says fans coffee. This is language that people speak, but it's also cleaned up by Pearl Clegg to give it emphasis. And that's what good writing is. Good writing kind of hammers a point to us. It's not just lots of words, and we're trying to find out what the meaning is. She lets us know what the meaning is. So it's almost like she's got like a microscope that she draws our focus to what's important in a line. That's the artistry of a playwright, is that there's a poet working in there as well. Sorry for that comment, but on our study guide, you know, we have character, action, and you'll notice under themes I have language. That's another part of analyzing a play. And language is not what the character says. Language is how the character says it. And the way that all the characters speak in this play puts us there in Nicodemus in the 1880s. It's a world away from our world, but not so, not too much. You can recognize the way people speak. All right, so let's move on here. This is interesting. We now have at the bottom, in terms of the plot, Sophie has talked about trying to organize an effort to protect their land against speculators. They don't want their neighbors, their black neighbors, to sell out to the high prices that are now being offered for the land around them. They want to keep their integrity here. We also have established that she's very much at odds with Miss Leah, but they're close. There's a close relationship between the two of them. And there's a section here where Sophie says, a lot of colored settlements have already passed rules saying nobody can sell to outsiders unless everybody agrees. And Miss Leah argues, ain't nobody going to give you the right to tell them when and how to sell their land. No point in owning it if you can't do what you want with it. Sophie says, but half of them will sell to speculators. You know they will. Miss Leah says, then that's what they're going to have to do. Sophie says, we could have so much here if these colored folks would just step lively. We could own this whole prairie. Nothing but colored folks' farms and colored folk wheat fields and colored folks' cattle everywhere you look. Nothing but colored folks. But they can't see it. They look at Nicodemus and all they see is a bunch of scuffling people trying to get ready for the winter instead of something free and fine for all our own. Most of them don't even know what we're doing here. Miss Leah says, well, that's because some of them come because they ain't never had nothing that belonged to them. Some of them come because they can't stand the smell of the city. Some of them just tired of evil white folks. Some of them killed somebody or wanted to. All everybody got in common is they plunked down $12 for a piece of good land, and now they're trying to live on it long enough to claim it. Sophie says, everybody isn't even doing that. And Miss Leah says, everybody doing the best they can, Sister Sophie. And Sophie says, when what happens when that isn't good enough? Miss Leah says, then they have to drink your coffee. Another humorous line to end the debate, but what we have here is not really dramatic conflict, but we have a really hot argument. Miss Leah is not really against Sophie, but she's kind of like playing devil's advocate. She's telling her why she thinks Sophie is going to have a hard time trying to get this resolution passed that's going to involve having some integrity about not selling your land to speculators, right? So she's arguing with Sophie on this account. And you get a sense that there's a battle going on here, and it's hotly debated, but it's not necessarily conflict. If Miss Leah was forcibly going to try to get Sophie to give up trying to get this resolution passed, then we might have conflict. But Miss Leah is just arguing the opposite side. So it's not dramatic conflict. We're going to get dramatic conflict when Frank arrives, right? This is all exposition, and we're establishing character. We're establishing Sophie's goal for the whole town. So part of letting us know in the audience who you are is letting us know what you want. Dramatic characters are defined by what their objectives are. We live our lives, yes, we want to finish college. Yes, we want this job that's going to pay better. Yes, we want our kids to be healthy. There's a lot of things we want. But in a play, your central character usually wants one thing, and that defining focus is what makes a play a segment of life, a part of life. Okay, it's more cleaned up, if you will, than the mess of our lives, right? That's why it's more artistic than how we have to live our everyday. Okay, so that first scene establishes a lot and establishes character very well and situation. Very important to a play. I could talk about that one scene endlessly, but let's move on. We do get now a new character coming in. Now we get Fanny, who's going to be contrasted with Sophie. So you see there's two very opposite kinds of women here. I don't know. No one's responded yet about my question about stereotypes. But one of the things that is enjoyable in this play is to see how different Sophie is from Fanny, from Miss Leah, from Minnie. And that gives us a sense of depth to the characters. And thus, we don't regard them as stereotypical. Miss Leah, isn't she the typical old black matriarch, kind of grumbling all the time? I mean, you could literally say, isn't she a stereotype? I don't think so, not with the history that's going to be brought out here of her own experience. The depth that Miss Leah is coming from makes her very unique, even though people in the audience will recognize the character very well. But I wouldn't say she's a stereotype. I don't know. I'd be curious to see if some of my students feel that about her. So Will and Fanny, they had been collecting flowers, and obviously there's a little romantic interest here. And Will comes in, and he's telling Fanny, they're outside, so they're not there in that same scene with Miss Leah and Sophie. But he's talking about how he loves Mexico. It's warm there. I like to swim, being from Florida and all, so I close my eyes and I jump in real quick, but that water would nigh about kill a Mexican. They don't know nothing about no cold. They even eat their food hot. And they talk about Mexico. In fact, we find out from Will that he actually was brought up by Native Americans in Florida, and that perhaps allowed him to then spend 7 years in Mexico and be very content with the world there. It's interesting. Will just said something that doesn't sound too literate, does it? They don't know nothing about no cold. All right, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 words, and listen to the sound of O through the sentence. They don't know nothing about no cold. In 7 words, you get 6 O sounds. Now, this doesn't sound very literate, but quite honestly, this is alliteration. This is a famous English term that allows for the repetition of a certain sound. Sibilance does the same thing when you use a succession of S's, for instance. So an alliterative sequence, you find it in Shakespeare's sonnets, you find it in contemporary poets. This is Pearl Clegg taking the everyday idiom and improving it to make it poetic. Any actor will tell you, this is fun to say. They don't know nothing about no cold. In fact, if you made the about, which would be the correct word, right? They don't know nothing about no cold. It's weird. It throws the rhythm off. To some extent, what a playwright is writing is music. Okay? Don't think of it as words. This flows so wonderfully. It's nice to say. They don't know nothing about no cold. It's not what you say. It's how you say it that helps determine character. So we know Will's background by how he talks, and in fact, we get a sense of an easy flow of dialogue here. So, you know, this may sound strange, but good English is the death of good playwriting. Any good playwright will tell you that if you write a play with the king's English in it, so that instead of Will saying, they don't know nothing about no cold, he says, they don't really have much of an experience with cold weather in Mexico, you'd be saying, wait a minute, that's not Will. Will doesn't speak like that. That's totally weird. When did he become, you know, one of the king's professors? So good language in a play is how people speak every day. Improved to make it more poetic and fluid, so that when actors speak it, we're going to hear these words. It doesn't sound stiff and academic. It sounds natural and everyday. That's one of the most frustrating things I can tell you about writing a play, is that you have to make it sound like you and me, not like, you know, some aristocratic leader of a nation. It can't sound like, for instance, in education, we love writing academic language that makes it sound very, very important, right? In a play, it would be deadly, all right? So to some extent, you have to be a little more open to accept that good playwriting involves poor speaking habits, if you will. It involves giving it a flavor of where that character is really from, when, what their socioeconomic background was. This is a real person speaking. You get a sense that Will has a whole history here, and he's not a stereotype just because he's not speaking the king's English. So interesting that I'm picking on that one phrase, but I can guarantee you every sentence in this book has an authenticity to it that is not an attempt to characterize black Americans as not being able to speak well. This is beautiful language. Okay? It's an interesting debate, I guess, we could have. Maybe some of you would want to debate that myself. So we find out about Will, and there's this wonderful section where Fanny says to him, you know, I wish you'd just call me Fanny. And again, here's Pearl Clegg doing something quite unique. If she had said, just call me Fanny, or I'd like you to just call me Fanny, she says, I wish you'd call me Fanny, meaning that Will and she have known each other for a while now. It's not like they've just met, and she's saying, oh, you can call me Fanny. She's saying, I wish you'd call me Fanny, meaning, how come you don't accept that we're friends here? In fact, Fanny is very interested in Will, but he's a little reticent, right? Maybe a little shy. It's actually somewhat humorous that she says, I wish you'd call me Fanny. And his response is interesting. I didn't mean to offend you, miss. And he's about to say Miss Fanny again. I just sort of like to call you that because it reminds me that a colored woman is a precious jewel deserving of my respect, my love, and my protection. Now, this is a everyday farmer who actually now does say something that is quite erudite, right? I mean, that phrase sticks out. It reminds me that a colored woman is a precious jewel deserving of my respect, my love, and my protection. And Fanny says, why, Will, what a sweet thing to say. And he explains where that phrase actually comes from. My mother taught it to me. She used to make me say it at night, like other folks said prayers. There were some other things she said too, but I can't remember them anymore. When I first run off after they sold her, right, he was born into slavery, I tried to close my eyes and remember her voice saying them, but all them new Indian words was looking for a place in my head. So I lost them all, but that one I just told you. She used to say if a colored man could just remember that one thing, life would be a whole lot easier for the colored woman. So this is, I'm answering to some extent, Kathy's question about pick a character from the play and try to identify what they stand for. Well, Will stands for a respect for black women that certainly isn't there with Frank when Frank comes in. In fact, I guess we have to ask, what is the real dramatic function of Will? Why is this character in a play? And this is another part about understanding a play. You have to even ask yourself, why is this guy even in the play? What is the dramatic function of this character? If you don't have Will in the play and you just have Frank, then you don't have something to contrast them. Will is actually called a foil. In other words, his good qualities, his admirable qualities, help to make Frank look even worse. So, to some extent, using contrast is, you know, one of the oldest artistic points of balance of all. I mean, a photograph is based on that kind of contrast of light and shade. So, a playwright is actually organizing the cast of characters to make points as well. So, realize it. There's a strong dramatic reason for Will to be in the play, and as he says goodbye to her and Fanny puts a flower on his lapel, you get the sense that something's going on, and Miss Leah will bring that up when they enter, when Fanny comes into the scene. So Miss Leah's purposely humming at Sophie as if to suggest that there's something going on out there. And we also find out that Fanny is very interested in, she asks Miss Leah, let's just finish the one we were working on Sunday night. Do you want to work on some of your stories tonight? And then Miss Leah says, I'm too tired. I keep telling you, these ain't writing stories. These are telling stories. this was just after Miss Leah had this wonderful long monologue where she talks about these young women wouldn't have lasted a minute before the war. Overseer make you squat down right beside the field and drop your baby out like an animal. All 10 of my sons was born after sundown because that was the only way to be sure I could lay down to have them. Franny says, how did your babies know it was nighttime? Miss Leah says, I knew it. So she's talking about how she held the babies inside her until after dark and then gave birth to them. And 10 of her children were born in slavery. So Miss Leah has this kind of long story about giving birth and preventing the overseer from seeing them too soon. Again, what does that establish? Why does Miss Leah have these stories? And now Fanny introduces this idea, first time we hear it, that she wants to write down some of the stories that Miss Leah is telling. And Miss Leah doesn't understand. She says, these are telling stories, not writing stories. But what is the significance of Fanny having to create a book that documents their story, their struggle? So there's a lot of history involved in this play, and there's a lot of awareness that the steps that these women are taking are very, very significant. So, we get this whole story that Fanny is writing the stories down, and Miss Leah is the storyteller of the play. And that's going to factor into a major sweep at the end of the play when Miss Leah tells a story that's going to solve the problem of the play, meaning Frank. I see Catherine has another comment here. This is great. Thank you, Catherine. I wondered if there is a political statement in the freedom of land ownership, but Sophie wanting people to get approval from their neighbors before they can sell their land. A political statement in the freedom of land ownership. It's interesting in contrast because the ability to own land in a way is at least perceived at this time as an act of freedom, that you actually have a sense of expressing a more open expression, whereas maybe today land ownership has a contrary connotation. But that interesting comment, Catherine. Thank you for that. There is very much a political statement in the idea of blacks owning their own land at this time in history. So the idea of coming from the slavery years and now settling the West is a huge step, very significant step, especially if we're talking post-Civil War. So thank you, Catherine. Keep responding to these questions. That's great. So this scene finally ends. This is the first scene of the play. There's a lot of information in it. The scene ends in a very interesting way, for instance. All of a sudden, Sophie says, shh. Now, they had just been debating back and forth in the same way that Miss Leah and Sophie have an argument. Fanny and Sophie have an argument. That argument is about Sophie's distrust of Frank, that Minnie is returning for a visit with her new husband, and they haven't seen each other for like a year and a half. They're coming back from London. Fanny talks about how she misses a lot of the social world that they had in Memphis, which is where the family kind of left with the other exodusters, as they were called, and how Fanny is excited to see her, but how Sophie is a little suspicious about Frank. So they've had that debate back and forth. And then, again, Clegg finishes the scene with something very visual. All of a sudden, Sophie says, shh, and she motions toward the candle. Fanny blows it out immediately. Sophie clicks the gun quickly into place and loads two shells into place. She goes quickly to the window and peers out. Fanny stands motionless, watching her. Right? It's a reminder that they're not living in Palos Verdes here. They are in a world where at any moment they might be attacked. They have to have that shotgun ready to go. And this could be a moment of major confrontation. But then what happens is Sophie breathes a sigh of relief and says, dear, three of them, come look. Sophie sets the gun down. The two stand looking at the deer in the moonlight. And it becomes something of a resolution moment, because then Sophie says to Fanny, I'll be nice to Frank for Min's sake. Butter won't melt in my mouth. Fanny says, promise. Sophie says, I promise. It's a great moment that kind of reflects a kind of resolution to the conflict they've just been having. So the appearance of the deer is a kind of peaceful attempt. So we want to, before we go and get Frank and Minnie from the train, we want to establish that Sophie's going to accept him. In fact, now we have a great comment here. Sophie says, did you talk to Miss Leah out of going to the station with us? And Fanny says, I think so. Sophie says, you did? How? Fanny says, I told her that you didn't think it was a good idea. Sophie says, well, no wonder she's mad at me. Fanny says, she's always mad at you. And Sophie says, well, good, maybe she'll live to be 100. Fanny had asked her earlier, why do you two argue so much? Why are you always picking at each other? And Sophie says, she'll live longer if she's more angry, which a lot of people believe that. If you still have the fight in you, you'll live longer years. So it's old school wisdom, I would guess. But it also, what Clegg does, this is the end of the first scene, it raises our interest in the idea of going to the train station. And sure enough, the next scene, we have the lights go down in the scene. Next scene comes up, and we are welcoming Frank and Minnie from the train station. So it's editing. Editing is usually a term you use in film, but to some extent, we are segueing into the next scene here. So making it a smooth transition. Clegg does that throughout the play. It's beautifully done for that in that respect. The train scene is quite wonderful as well, because we have such great moments like Frank coming in, and he immediately has this association with Fanny and gives her a signed copy of Paul Laurence Dunbar's latest book. And Fanny is just delighted that he was able to pick this up in New Orleans for her. So there's a kind of alliance there, whereas the relationship between Frank and Sophie, you can tell, is a little strange. Sophie hardly says a word in this train scene, right? It's all the excitement of Minnie talking about her French hat and Fanny being all excited about her being there. But then the end of the scene, for instance, Sophie does say, welcome to Nicodemus, Frank. Great little piece of staging. Frank tips his hat, bows slightly. Now, Frank has been introduced as a very elaborately dressed man. Frank has entered and stands watching them. Frank is immaculately dressed in fine clothes from head to toe, coat, hat, suit, gloves, shirt, everything of the finest quality and very tasteful. The sheer richness of the clothing is obvious in every piece, which makes Frank really stand out from this rather rugged frontier world that he's entering. It's almost a statement that Frank doesn't fit in too well here. Frank belongs somewhere else. It's a visual statement that you have in your head. You don't even intellectually acknowledge it, but it's there. And anyway, the final moment of the scene is terrific. And this is the playwright come up with this idea, okay? Frank tips his hat, bows slightly. He exits, pulling on his gloves, leaving his small suitcase behind. Now, everybody else has walked out except for him and Sophie. Sophie looks after him, looks at the bag, shifts the shotgun easily to the crook of her arm, picks up the bag, and exits. So this tells you everything about Frank, that he has the arrogance to not even carry his own bag. He leaves it there for Sophie to take, treating Sophie like his slave. So we all of a sudden get this attitude about Frank, and it's done without words. No one says this. You see it. You get the information yourself from the visual. It's a great way to end the scene. And so as we're segueing now into the dinner scene, this is scene 3 in the play. Obviously, I could spend hours talking about this play. It's just lush with information that translates easily in terms of who the characters are and what the conflict is. We get a table scene here now where they are all at the table, and one of the things that they do is they tell stories. They actually ask each other to tell stories, and there's reference to the stories that Fanny is copying down. Frank actually asks that Sophie tell the story of how they met, and Minnie tells the story of how she met Frank, so there's kind of a romantic interest established there. And there's throughout this whole scene, there's great bits that show the contrast of characters. For instance, when they all get up from the table to leave, we have Miss Leah leaves and everybody says goodbye to her. Fanny and Minnie begin clearing off the dishes from the table. Will unobtrusively helps them while Frank pours himself another glass of wine. So while Will is taking the dirty dishes from the table back to the kitchen, Frank says to him, "They don't make you do the woman's work around here too, do they, Parrish?" And Will says, "Makes it go quicker when everybody does a part." Fanny says, "I couldn't have said it any better myself." Again, reading a play, sometimes there are gems that if you just say, what did that just tell us? Obviously that Will is there to help out however he can, but Frank considers it too far below him to clear the table. The servants do that, right? The difference established between Frank and Will just in that moment is all you need to know about the characters. So a lot of writing a good play is to kind of accomplish a lot with very little. Be selective in what the characters say and do to give the audience a clear idea of who they are. I mean, that's a priceless bit in the scene. And then at the end of the dinner scene, we have an amazing occurrence here. The sisters decide that they want to go outside after dinner, and they actually rush out. Will can be seen sharpening a small knife on a stone. Frank takes out a cigar, prepares it. The women stand in a circle holding hands, and that's actually that image from our Theater of Revolt logo. And you get the women saying, "Because we are free Negro women." And Fanny and Minnie say, "Because we are free Negro women." Sophie says, "Born of free Negro women." Fanny and Minnie say, "Born of free Negro women." And then they all say together, "Back as far as time begins." Sophie says, "We choose this day to leave a place where our lives, our honor, and our very souls are not our own," referring to their leaving Memphis. Fanny says, "Say it, sister." That's exactly the moment that we're looking at right here. Well, it happens before that actual moment. And Sophie says, "We choose this day to declare our lives to be our own and no one else's. And we promise to always remember the day we left Memphis and went west together to be free women as a sacred bond between us with all our trust." And then the women repeat, "All our strength, all our courage, all our trust." And then Sophie ends the scene saying, "Welcome home, baby sister," and the three embrace. And that's a wonderful piece of directing by Sue Trouth to give them that wonderful celebratory moment. And as we said earlier, there's Frank in the background wondering, what's going on here? There's a community of women. My wife is part of a community of women celebrating their independence, right? To be free women, and it's a sacred bond between us. So Frank's suspicions are strong just in the visual. It's a great visual there, even before you even understand what they're saying in the scene. So this is a play that works on so many different levels, but we've already established who everyone is and the situation of the play. We kind of need a little bit of a spark, and that's what we're going to get now in the next scene. You know, a good play is arranged in a way to tell a story. It's not just storytelling. It's a placement so that one scene causes the next. Now that we've had this suspicion about Frank, now he's going to kind of attack Minnie for it. All right? He kind of gets back at her. And we have this wonderful scene where Minnie comes down in the morning and Miss Leah braids her hair for her the way that she had always done when she was a little girl. And in fact, Frank met her, supposedly, Minnie says, with her hair in braids. So when Frank sees her, for those of you who are following on page 42, Frank says, "What have you done to your hair? Miss Leah braided it for me like she used to. I've never seen you with your hair in plaids." Minnie says, "Yes, you have. I was wearing braids when you first met me." And Miss Leah, at this point, leaves. She has to go outside. And the first thing Frank says when Miss Leah leaves, he says this to Minnie. He says, "I want you to put your hair back the way it was." Minnie says, "I always wore my..." And he cuts her off. "You look like a damn pickaninny. We haven't been here 24 hours and look at you." Minnie, "I'm sorry." Frank, "You're always sorry, aren't you?" "Of course you are. But you weren't so busy being sorry. You'd know there are some interesting things going on in Nicodemus these days." Minnie says, "What do you mean?" Frank, "Nothing. I'm going to town to check at the telegraph office." And this is where Frank's going to find out about how valuable the land that they own really is. And that's going to cause more problems. But the spark that is here now is we get our first glimpse of Frank literally being abusive to Minnie. The scene that began with the dinner, Minnie comes downstairs and she's got a bruise on her head and she kind of tells everybody she fell on the train. And all the sisters are a little suspicious about that. And she wears her hat down low to cover it. So now we know that there's a deep distrust at the heart of this marriage. So that's the little spark. Now we need a big spark, and this is going to bring us to the end of the first act. At this point, Frank comes back from his time there, and there's a great bit here, and then this is more character creation, but on page 44, Sophie brings out the plans of the town and shows them to Minnie. Now, Sophie is not a person who's just talked about how great it would be if we had this and that. She has a blueprint, literally, with a whole outline of the layout of the town that Fanny has actually gone in and put in people's faces. So we have, Sophie says, "Look, there's Fan put us all in it. Here I am at the feed store, and here's a picture of Will at the blacksmith, and here you are at the train station. Oh, and Miss Lee is on here someplace." And Minnie says, "She forgot to draw Frank." And Sophie says, "I guess she did." Minnie says, "You know I'd come back if I could, don't you? I think you would if you wanted to. It's not that simple. Why isn't it? Doesn't anybody really know what they want? Do you?" So we get a little bit of tension between Minnie and Sophie over Frank, and that Frank is not visually in the actual blueprints for the town. Another very significant statement. And we find out perhaps why this antagonism is furthered with Minnie and Sophie talking about Frank, but it's pretty clear when Frank comes back from town and says that he was gambling with some of the white men he was passing. In other words, they accepted him as a white man. They didn't know that he was mulatto, mixed race. So he's playing cards with him, and he loses all their money gambling, right? But he finds out that, you know, your sisters are sitting on a fortune. That white man on the train, he said, speculators are paying top dollar for these farms around here. And immediately Minnie says, oh, sisters would never sell their land. And Frank kind of talks about how many of the black people in the town are so unaware of, you know, what's valuable. And Minnie says, were you passing? Frank says, I was letting people draw their own conclusions. Minnie says, who did you tell them I was? And at this point, Frank's anger comes out again, and he says, I told you to shut up. And he pushes her roughly, and she stumbles and falls to the floor at the moment that Sophie enters from the porch. Fanny, who had been in bed, follows almost immediately, awakened by the noise. So we actually get a moment, and this is the end of the first act. Tell me if you don't think this is an interesting way to send people off to the intermission, thinking about what's going to happen in the second act. So he pushes her, she falls, the sisters run in. Fanny says, Minnie, my God. Sophie says, what do you think you're doing to Frank? Frank says, I'm talking to my wife. This is none of your affair. Minnie says, it's all right. It was an accident. I just slipped. Didn't I, Frank? I just slipped. Just as she explained her bruise on the train, which was really from Frank. Sophie says, get out. Frank says, you're pretty high and mighty for a nigger woman, aren't you? Minnie says, shut up, Frank. He's drunk. Don't listen to him. Frank, what did you say? And Frank starts to move towards Minnie in a threatening manner. Sophie raises the shotgun and cocks it. So in other words, we get a moment here where Sophie, that shotgun that she had in the very beginning, now she's aiming it at Frank. And Minnie says, no, sister, don't. Please don't. I'm going to have a baby. All stop and stand there, and the lights go down. All right. Now, this is drama. This is theater. Okay. This is showing us what's happening in a visual moment. Sophie versus Frank. So Sophie's got the gun on him, right? And he just, you know, called her the N-word, right? Which even raises for all of us a major significant attack on his part. He is mulatto himself. It's interesting that he would use that word to identify Sophie. So the whole scene, the whole act, I mean, as people are going to an intermission, this is actually great playwriting, because you're asking yourself, is Sophie going to shoot him? But no, she can't, because now we find out that Minnie is pregnant, and we're wondering what is going to happen. And also we have that information that he knows that the women's land is valuable. So it sets your mind off wondering what's going to happen in the second act, and you're going to come back to the second act because of that. So while you're getting your coffee or going to the bathroom or whatever you're doing during an intermission, the play is still alive. That's great artistry. I mean, that is a unique way to finish with something that has some impact. And as I said in the beginning, Clegg knows how to write so that you have emphasis. You're drawn into the situations. And that's the true action of a good play. Well, I see we have some comments here from some of our students, so let's share this here. This is Erica saying that Sophie is constantly being compared to a man, boots, shotgun, property owner, leader. I don't know that a woman can't be a leader, but yes, Sophie has more of the male side, whereas Fanny has more of the female side. And that's a significant point for Clegg. We don't want her to be considered as some aberration. She ends the play going off to a dance, being given a brooch by Minnie that was her mother's, right? So she puts her shotgun away at the end of the play to go off to the dance. There's a time to be feminine and there's a time to be masculine. Carl Jung would say, you know, we both have both of those sides. So maybe we've got a Sophie who is in her protector stage in the progress of the play. And that there's a great line, though. You're right in the way that you said this, that she's constantly being reminded of manly virtues. And Miss Leah has a great line where, I forget where she says it, but she says, maybe someday there'd be a chance that some man would be interested in you, kind of putting her down for being so manly herself in all of the things that she's doing for the estate. So good point. Thank you for putting that in there. And here's Crystal. Thank you, Crystal. Crystal's saying, the author also made it a point to let us know which characters were born into slavery. While reading the play, you can see how this shapes each character's attitude about their existence. Yes, and it's very specific who's coming from where and how those 7 years in Mexico affected Will and made him a little more accepting, perhaps, than certainly Frank. And how Frank has, and Crystal, I'm going to use your point, too, to point out that all these characters come from somewhere. And one of the best ways to avoid stereotyping is to give your character roots, to let them, to give us a kind of believability. Question was asked about Electricidad, that if we had a little more detailing of Electricidad's character and where that kind of hatred for her mother came from, there'd be more depth in there. So, to some extent, all the characters in this play have a history. You could see how Frank is a spoiled brat, that he, at one time, did have a father who was a plantation owner and was perhaps given too much. Now he walks about and expects to be living in high society, and here he is stuck in Nicodemus, and his anger is about to explode. Well, thank you, Crystal. That's a very good comment. Well, now, I knew this was going to happen. I only have one act covered. Not that I was really intending to go through the play, but I hope that I was able to look in some depth in the play to make you see what works for a play. And that's not easy at times to find out. I do want to end with one of my students' comments. This is a beautiful discussion board posting, and I don't even want to mention who wrote it because I don't want to put one head higher, but these are the kinds of investigations that I really appreciate from looking at these plays, and that's what this is about, is getting into the play so that you really get a feel for it. I believe that Clegg made two of her characters, Frank and Sophie, mulatto to give us opposing views of what a person does to overcome a social stigma. Frank displays his anger overtly in mostly every scene where Clegg inserts him. We see a fragile and tormented man who is searching for his place in life. Does he participate in life as a black man, a white man, a biracial man, just a man? The settings Clegg chooses, London, Memphis, Kansas, are places of circumstance that perpetuate Frank's internal struggle. Important to consider as well are the responses of the other characters in Flying West to Frank. I mean, I just think it's wonderful that we have this comment about how Frank is a fragile and tormented man. Many feel that he's something of a stereotype or too overtly a villain. But Clegg does try to give him some depth to make him stand out. Well, if you haven't got to read Flying West, or if there's a production coming into your neighborhood, please take a look at it because it's a wonderful, wonderful play. I'll see you next Sunday on Father's Day to look at Antigone. See you then.